Hi, I'm Saurabh. I work as a principal engineer in Zeotap. I've been with Zeotap since the day it was a single table startup.
To know more about Zeotap, Zeotap in a single line can be described as a tech identity and data platform, which helps brand understand their customers better.
Today we presented the world's largest native JanusGraph database backed by Scylla, being run into production as a part of our Connect product.
Hope you enjoy the video about our experiences and the presentation.
So let's jump directly into the content. What we are presenting here today is logically a two-part presentation, where the first part is sharing information about our journey of productionalizing JanusGraph on top of Scylla for one of our core products, which is called Connect, which is the identity resolution product. And the second part is sharing our experience of running this production system for the past 1 year. Okay? So with that, a brief introduction about the company and us. Zeotap is an identity and data platform. We specialize in collecting people-centric data. People-centric data is of two flavors. One is the identity data, and another is the profile data of people. And our mission is to enable brands better understand their customers. And how we achieve it is by integrating with their AdTech and MarTech stack. And other salient points about Zeotap, we host probably today one of the largest identity graphs of people. So when I say largest, we host a graph of close to 16 billion nodes, and in that 8 billion edges, and somewhere around 3.6 billion unique IDs of that. Then we are fully privacy compliant. Zeotap is a Berlin-based company. So given EU is one of our primary markets, we have GDPR and full privacy compliance. We source data from close to 80 plus data partners and fan out data to 40 plus destinations, close to 1 to 2 billion IDs are fanned out per day. Now coming to the use case or the product itself, what is identity resolution? Let's take an example. Most of the audience here might be having one or two mobile phones. You might have a tablet, you might probably have an IPTV, and probably you have enrolled a couple of loyalty programs with your airlines and clubs and all these. So each of these is going to generate an identifier for you. If it's a mobile, it is going to generate something called a mobile identifier, AdID or Google cookie, Google IDs, Google AdID or IDFA in iOS. And if you're visiting website, you're going to create cookie identifiers for you. And if you're going to do loyalty programs, you're going to provide your email ID and phone numbers as identifiers to them. Identity resolution is nothing more than connecting all these identities together to create a singular view of the customer. That's exactly what I have showcased here in the next slide. If you look at the right-hand side, it is about the various data sources which can generate identities for you. And we kind of merge it to create a singular identity from multiple identity sources. The main takeaway of this slide is the linkages or the connections between the identities are more valuable than the individual identities which you see on the right-hand side. So the linkages are more important, how you link and make them together. So that is the identity resolution. Now, okay, this is identity resolution. What is the use case? What is the business case with identity resolution? The first two which I have listed there, the match test and export or the monetization, which actually drive the money generation from the identity resolution. Match test, again, let me explain with an example. Suppose one of Zeotap's customers comes and gives, hey, I have 1 million email IDs. Can you tell me what is the match percentage of this? So with the 1 million email IDs, what we do is a simple join. It's an inner join of our data set. Say we have 500K IDs, which is a 50%. Another thing is, from the 500K identifiers, we have a transitive link to the other identifiers. But like a person has multiple identifiers, so we have a transitive link to the other identifiers. So this transitive link together forms like 2 million IDs. So that means you have a 200% match rate. And this is what is the match test use case. Second is, okay, the customer is happy with the match test. We are consistently performing above 70% match test. Customer wants to activate the IDs. In which case, we need to retrieve the IDs from the graph and give it to them. So the retrieval is called as the export use case. Third is the reporting. Reporting is your classic counts and aggregations. Then, of course, being GDPR compliance, this is a very important point. We have to provide opt-out of any identifier, when a customer asks for an opt-out. Then third-party extension, we have a slide which explains this. This is fundamentally linking our graph with a third-party identity provider who gives this bunch of identities to us for to be extended. For compliance and other reasons, we cannot gel both the graphs together, and it has its own life cycle, so that is called the third-party extension. Then the other very important thing, which is the identity quality, all data assets of Zeotap, we pride ourselves in collecting high-quality data. And how we achieve high-quality data, we'll just show the V1 of the identity quality, which we use the GraphDB to achieve it. So there is a slide which has a deep dive on the quality too. Then the other, the classic product task, anytime they want all the test results, everything yesterday. They would give today, but they'll want the results yesterday. So short SLAs for freshness of data, that means you need to have real quick ingestion as well as real quick query performance. So that is the use cases. And just quickly skimming through the V1 or MVP implementation, which is a classic batch job where you have the Spark processing, create a dedupe, merge, and snapshot in S3, and we have Ethna in S3 for ad hoc query, and the match test and export is via Spark processing via Redshift. So this is our old implementation. But when we started crossing the 3 billion scale, we really saw our SLAs going towards 1+ day, 24+ hour mark. And we were looking at SLAs of somewhere around 2 to 3 hours, or say less than 6 hours. So we were looking at this storage area to see if anything can be changed there. Now, if you look at it, we distilled down the storage into a couple of aspects. What is required from the storage? So from the write perspective, read perspective, housekeeping perspective, as well as the workload perspective, that is what is listed down here. From the workload, when the match test is happening, that is when the retrieval is happening, you can have data pouring into the system. That is called the ingestion. So it is a simultaneous high read and high write can happen on your system. Your storage should be able to handle that. Then your write, it has to support ingestion. Write means the modifications here. It has to support ingestion as well as deletion for the GDPR compliance perspective. And at that scale of 3 billion and plus close to 300 million ingestions, we wanted a SLA. To meet our SLAs, we wanted 50K TPS at a minimum, 50K writes per second at a minimum. And housekeeping, again, derives from the contractual obligations and the compliance obligations. A storage which can give TTL out of the box was something we wanted to consider. And coming to the read workload, the match test and export, what I told, I have just expanded them here. Match test is more of lookup and retrieval of IDs. Then the actual retrieval of IDs is the export. Retrieval could be base retrieval, or it can be based on conditions, whatever I listed there. You can ask a specific type of identifiers, or you can ask retrieval based on a couple of properties of your identifiers. So that is a retrieval. And count is something interesting. Zeotap does not buy data from any of our data sources. What we have is revenue share agreement. If your data performs, you get a percentage of the revenue for yourself. So for the revenue share, whenever I retrieve the ID, I also need to have the knowledge of from which data partner the ID has been retrieved. So for each retrieval, I need to have the count of data partners, which is giving me the knowledge for that retrieval. So that is the count use case. And the depth filters is like, suppose the transitive link is for 10 depth or 5 depth or 6 depth. People sometimes want to cut, saying that I don't want a ID which is beyond a depth of 4 or which is having an indirection of 4 times or 3 times. So this is something which is asked from product. So we were looking at these two. So there was time to change. If you look at it, whatever I've been talking, parlances like transitivity, depth, connections, linkages, these are all directly what you have studied in college in graph theory. So we thought, is there a ID graph that can directly replace my storage and give all this out of the box? And that is when we thought we'll try POCs and productionalizing the V1 of their system using an ID graph. And welcome GraphDB to our ecosystem. Okay.
So thanks, Satish. I'll be mostly taking care of the data modeling and the data store why we chose. So let's start with introducing GraphDB. As Satish mentioned, if you think about the context, it is about reaching the maximum number of IDs which are directly connected to an input ID or indirectly connected to an input ID. A graph database suffices for us because it gives us the four properties. One of the foremost requirement here is that we should be able to traverse the neighborhood of a given ID in the least time possible. And the scale that we are discussing, or the 15 billion kind of scale, the latency for each lookup needs to be sub-seconds. Otherwise, it will add up to our SLA and it would be poorly accepted in the market. The second piece is linkages are first-class citizen. As we discussed in terms of business, the linkages are more important than the vertices here. The linkages, the links between the IDs are more important than the IDs themselves. Why? Because these linkages have a lot of metadata. Some of this metadata is like recency metadata. How recent is this link? Some metadata is like which data partner gave this a link when. Some of the other attributes like quality scores, which we derive from our data science pipelines, are also linkage attributes. So we wanted something that gives linkages the first-class citizenship, and we can leverage these linkages while traversing our graph for the match test workflow. Apart from this, using a data store aligns you with a delta ingestion mode. In the sense, you can do absurd kind of ingestion. You need not do spark, batch joins, and load data somewhere. The data is already there. You touch only the new items that need to be touched. For the OLAP use case, with recent advances in MPP style of processing given by Spark and Apache Tinkerpop stack, we were able to see that, okay, this store would also suffice our analytics use cases. And finally, with all of the tech pieces, the tech advantages that we get, we also have something for our customers, for our analysts. They are able to understand the graph it as it is. They need not think anymore in terms of relational tables, wherein if they want to reach a depth of two, they would have to do two joins. Those kind of constraints are gone. The queries are much simpler and they are much comprehensible. Here we had a gremlin ramp-up curve, but it is worth it if given the advantages that we get out of this gremlin query language for traversing the graph. Let's move on to the POCs and findings. What were our data store candidates, and what was our benchmark data volumes and the access patterns. So we did a POC in August 2018 for a couple of openly available graph databases. If you see this slide, we POC'd three native graph databases, JanusGraph backed by Scylla, OrientDB, and DGraph. Given our scale, we were suspicious that none of these stores may be directly enabling us to achieve what we want. So we also had a plan B, which was implement the entire DFS algorithm via UDF facility in Aeropike, which we knew would work because of our production experience with Aeropike till that point in time. These are the findings. So if you see the title, our aim was to test the workload, which was at least 3x of the existing workload, which meant we tried this with 3 billion IDs and 1 billion edges. As we just mentioned, we are right now 15 billion plus. It's the current state. At the POC time, we tried with 3 billion edges and 3 billion vertices and 1 billion edges. Couple of design decisions that we found aligned with us at this scale, primarily being the label property graph model. So if you go into the graph theory of how we represent graphs, we get two specific formats. One of them is labeled property graph model, and one is RDF model of representation. We figured out that LPG works for us because in RDF, we just increase the cardinality of data points because every edge there becomes a vertex. Secondly, we were also looking at the cost of the entire solution. An Aerospike-based solution would have been costlier. It's a memory-based KV with persistence compared to a Scylla-based solution, which is a disk-based KV store. And cost of the solution was also of huge importance to us. We finally figured out that, okay, the benchmark data was only getting loaded on Aerospike and JanusGraph. Given cost of the solution of Janus is much lesser than Aerospike, we proceeded with JanusGraph backed by ScyllaDB.
A point in the data model, graph theory typically suggests the GraphDB data model promises two things. One is the extreme flexibility in terms of schema evolution. And another thing is the expressiveness of your domain. So we'll just see in the coming slides how these two are working out for us. Yeah.
So presenting to you one of the simplest models in which we were able to express our business domain. Our business domain inherently required a graph data structure. We got a graph database. We were able to represent model in this way. If you see, there are a few points here. These boxes represents users' digital identities. The edges between these identities represent the linkages which are shared with Zeotap by the data partners. Let's go within the box. So there you would see there are a couple of properties. Now these are represented, these are stored as vertex properties in JanusGraph, and a couple of these properties I'll read out are user's device operating system, the country with to which the user belongs, this particular ID we synced from this country, and the list of data partners who shared this vertex with us. If you see the link, the edge, there is metadata there as well. One of the important metadata there is DPTS, as in which data partner shared this particular linkage at what point in time with us. And we have a quality score, which we'll come to in the later part of the presentation. Coming to the expressiveness of the model, we had three primary business read requirements. One of the most important there is transitive linkages. If you think about it, our ID graph keeps on getting built with time. With time, data partners keep on sharing linkages with us and our graph keeps on changing. So at any point in time, we do not store any pre-computed list of connected IDs to a particular ID. We do that at the time of traversal, and that is what I mean by transitive linkages. If you see the right side of the slide, starting from the email abc@gmail.com, it is connected to the leftmost side of the slide to that Google cookie, and we should be able to reach as part of our traversal, which we call as transitive linkages. The second is that the traversal, we should be able to control using the vertex and edge metadata. For example, one of the business use cases, the path that you use for traversal should not change the country. So if we start with an ID which belongs to, let's say, Spain, we should not take any edge which does not belong to Spain, or we should not export any ID which does not belong to Spain. We, in the same way, we have edge metadata, and one of the perspectives there is the quality. So I want my traversals to use only high quality linkages. They are highly valued and highly trusted linkages. The third piece was the extensibility of the data model. If you think about it, these edges and vertices can have different metadata, and we cannot change the schema and stop and restart at this scale. We needed something that allows us to add the metadata on the fly. An example there is link source. So that dotted link between the two IDs in the middle of the slide, no data partner has shared that linkage with us. It is our own heuristic that we were able to link them based on their IP subnets. They were basically co-located. So we tell, okay, it's a probabilistic edge. And we are able to express this dimension as well in our data model.
Coming to streaming ingestions, we'll start from the batch load. What happened is because of the merge and the redshift load time, it was somewhere around 10 to 12 hours for the streaming ingestion initially. It was a batch ingestion. From there, we moved to streaming. It's typically, as the usual suspect, Kafka was put inside, and the join of Spark was changed into a lookup into a KV store for the dedupe and enrichment. And another thing, I'll just come to this aspect. We started loading using a custom written component for Kafka called the streaming graph ingester, which took care of the retries and all these aspects of it. So the findings is, consider splitting vertex and edge. The reason is what we found is the vertex write behavior is very different from the edge write behavior. So vertex was a single write, whereas the edge was a lookup as well as a write. So we wanted to tweak the two workloads separately, and that is why we went for a splitting of the vertex and the edge in terms of loading the graph. And when we split the vertex and edge load, what we did is the edge also we could convert into a complete write, 100% write, by doing a client-side caching. So architecturally, this gave much more flexibility for us in terms of loading the vertex via separate Kafka and the edge via separate Kafka. So then coming to the traversal, which is the query access patterns. Now, traversal, there is no theory here in the sense most of you would have had some problem solving in terms of a shortest path algorithm. That is your traversal. At least if you haven't solved in the company, you would have solved at least in your interviews. So let's go into the findings there directly. One thing which can really, really degrade your traversal is your supernodes. There are two kinds of supernodes. A node which is connected to multiple client, multiple nodes together. Another is a node from which the depth is going on increasing. So we have just presented what we found in terms of the QPS degrade in terms of supernode. and in terms of the multi-depth traversal. So be wary of your supernodes. Second is play with your compaction strategies. Compaction strategies, for some reason, consistently we found that the level-tiered compaction strategies is working better for us. I'll leave it for the Scylla folks to theorize why it would have been the case. But this is what we got. And it also worked well when we were using concurrent clients. So the QPS we could stabilize at somewhere around 30K for concurrent clients. Another thing, very important thing in terms of traversal is, in spite of graph giving traversal advantages, you should know your query and your data, what you're trying to access. Let me give an example. For us here, most of the data access, I wouldn't say most, all of our data access is based on a country filter. So we need to filter based on countries when we retrieve the data. And that is two ways of doing it. One is you filter the country in the query and fetch it from the DB. Another is you take the full profile map and you do it in your client side. So what we figured out is, since our vertex metadata is not that huge in the current scenario, if it is like 100 plus metadata or properties, it would have been a different case. Currently, we have only 4 or 5. See this query, this is taking like 1 second, whereas this took somewhere around 2 seconds. So there is like a 200% increase. So it is always good to have a sense of your data when you're issuing queries. And this comes from production experience, naturally. And coming to the next important part, which is the ID graph analysis, which drove us to the quality control mechanisms of our ID data assets.
Yeah. Graph analysis, as we mentioned, Zeotap takes pride in highest quality data sets. In context of graphs, the specific quality problem that we get is how good are our clusters, how big they are, how trustable they are. In fact, one of the production clusters after ingestion we found was having around 63 million IDs in itself, which does not make sense, right? So what we decided at this point in time is, based on the graph structure that we have and the metadata that we have, let's leverage and put some kind of statistical modeling, which leads to edge scoring. And we are able to convert the match test as a ranking problem rather than just a simple traversal problem. So we'll briefly go through the edge scoring, how we did it. So it all starts with the AD scoring for every edge. So what AD means is agreement and disagreement score. Now, if you see here, A2, the ID A2 is linked to ID E2. The common data partner on this edge is 5 and 6, and the uncommon data partner, which does not agree with this existence, is 1. So we say the agreement score of this edge is 2, and disagreement score is 1. Pretty simple. We augment the AD score with the recency score, such that the most recent edges get higher score, which gives us a composite score. On top of that, we augment the composite score with the vertex metadata, in the sense that if the vertices, connected vertices for this particular edge have similar IP subnets, we boost the composite score. If the device operating system is different for the connected vertices, we penalize the composite score, which leads to a final score, which is stored as an edge metadata here. And now this edge metadata is used by the matched test traversal as a ranking problem. We'll quickly go through the OLTP and OLAP exports that we are doing in production. Match test, if you think about it, it's a OLTP use case because we touch a single ID at a time. The ID that clients give us, we do a custom DFS on top of that via lookup and gremlin query. And the property and the depth filtering is done on the application layer. The second use case where we are using the OLTP style of processing is across graph traversals. As we saw earlier, Zeotap also has multiple third-party graphs. And the client would want to access multiple graphs with his wish. Our application layer enables the client to chain the graphs at runtime. And these graphs are stored as separate Scylla key spaces, primarily because of two reasons, compliance and the nature of change. Some of the graphs are replaced completely. Some of them keep on getting edited. Based on these aspects, we decided to store them separately and chain them via application layer. OLAP export, this is the use case which is powering our data science quality analysis. Whatever data we have in JanusGraph, it is exported via Spark, TinkerPop, Spark Graph Computer in a Gryo format on S3, where the data science team runs their algorithm. The scores, we propagate back to the OLTP graph, which is the match test graph, and the OLAP ID graph.
Yeah, coming to the prod setup, we released V1 of this Connect system in November 2018. We are an AWS shop as of today. So it was running on i3.4x and started with 2 node. Now we are close to 3 and 4 node, depending on the regions. And again, the point on the level tiered strategy, this is what we are using in production. And stats, as I had given in the start of the talk, it's like the number of vertices and other things. Other important stat is currently we are running close to 150 to 200 match tests and exports per day. Okay, I'll end the talk with the final takeaway. So if you think about it, there are two primary workflows, what we have here. One is the ID overlap finder, and another is the ID retriever. Now, what we figured out after 4 months of production is the number of clients who's asking, okay, give me your match test percentage, is 4x higher than the clients who want to actually retrieve the data out. So when we are running both these workloads together in production, what we saw is there was a cannibalization between these two workloads within themselves. Even though both are read workloads, there was a cannibalization. And there was high SLA degrades in that, and there were also failure rates, which we couldn't explain to the product. So what we did is, we introduced something called prioritization throttling via what we have something called control plane. Zeotap has something called Mr. Shepherd, which is a control plane, which orchestrates all the data layer, and data layer only takes care of the data compute jobs. So in this, we introduced prioritization throttling, and prioritization also was introduced with aging so that the match test get priority, but it doesn't starve a export. And throttle is for the concurrent limitation of the jobs. So with this, we could achieve a P95 of reduction of 10 to 2 hours, and the job failure rates reduced from 20% in a day to 2% in a day. So, however good a tool you're using, people's thought process and architecture is very key to achieve good results in your product.